Oh, I love ending an evening with great music. Welcome, everyone. I'm Stacey Weaver, Executive Director of San Diego American Heart Association. Excited to have you join us today for this very timely conversation on how COVID-19 has impacted our cardiovascular health. In just a minute, we will hear from our speakers. But before that, I want to take a minute to highlight the work of the American Heart Association and Go Red for Women movement, of which Deloitte is a strong supporter and leader of. More than 17 years ago, the AHA launched Go Red for Women to bring awareness that heart disease is the number one killer of women, and that women are often misdiagnosed and unaware of lifestyle changes they can make to help prevent heart disease. We have made great strides in raising awareness, educating women, and providing programs and resources to those who need it most. But we must continue to do more as heart disease continues to claim the lives of 1 in 3 women. That's why we are grateful for those who can come alongside us, like Deloitte and Julie Moran, one of our exceptional volunteer leaders who sit on the board of directors and the Go Red for Women executive leadership team. Because of the support and investment of corporations and community members, we are educating more people than ever before on cardiovascular health, funding life-saving research, including $2.5 million in grants to study the impact of COVID on cardiovascular health, and breaking down barriers to health equity right here in San Diego. With that, it is my pleasure to introduce you to our host today, Julie Moran, San Diego's marketplace leader for Deloitte. Julie?
I think you're on mute, Julie.
I'm muted. Sorry, guys. Thank you, Stacey. I'm thrilled to be here today. Excited to learn a little bit more about the cardiovascular impacts of COVID-19 that we've learned through some of the research in the last year. Deloitte has been very focused in our life sciences and healthcare practice on what can we do to really affect change in health equity. And cardiovascular disease is so front and center to that because of the racial and socioeconomic implications of it. The other area that we're really focused on as well is how do we bend that cost curve around healthcare spending? And we have predictions that show by 2040, we're gonna have trillions of dollars freed up because we're going to be changing what we think about in terms of healthcare treatment. We're no longer going to be curing a disease, but we're going to spend more money on prevention and wellness. So I'm very excited to be here today. I've been part of the executive leadership team for Go Red for Women for almost a decade. I've been involved in Heart Walk, Cycle Nation, and I grew up as the daughter of an exercise physiologist and professor whose early research was all in cardiology rehabilitation. So this is very near and dear to my heart. I'd like to introduce Dr. Courtney Bennett to you. She is a board-certified cardiologist and critical care physician. She's a medical director of the Cardiac Intensive Care Unit and Mayo Quality Academy Gold Certified. Dr. Bennett cares for patients with many critical conditions in the CICU at St. Mary's Hospital. She went to medical school at Philadelphia College of Osteopathic Medicine, completed her internal medicine residency and cardiology fellowship at Lehigh Valley Hospital in Allentown, Pennsylvania, and her critical care medicine fellowship at Mayo Clinic in Rochester, Minnesota. Her interests include cardiac critical care and contrast echocardiology. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Bennett. Thank you.
Thank you, Julie. I'm going to share some slides here quickly. Thank you. I just want to thank everyone for the opportunity to meet with you this evening and discuss some of what has been near and dear to my heart for the last over a year now. Some of the slides that I'm gonna share with you tonight does have some copyright material, some of the data that I'm gonna share with you. And just to get this off the table, I have no financial disclosures to share. What I thought I would start with is actually just talking with you about what my experience and my colleagues' experience has been during this pandemic at Mayo Clinic. So I stepped into actually my leadership role in January of 2020. And as leaders yourself, you know that any new leadership role can be challenging. But one of the greatest challenges that will fall under my tenure is managing a pandemic during my role as the director in the CICU. And many of my predecessors didn't know how to guide me, and we had to learn how to navigate this together. And I will say that in Rochester, Minnesota, where we're located, during the first wave of the pandemic, we were relatively spared compared to what the coasts were experiencing in terms of the burden of COVID-19. What we did see early on, which was very concerning to us, is that patients were scared. They were scared to come to the hospital. We didn't have a good understanding of really how to protect our patients and ourselves very early on. And something that was the greatest concern to us, and something that the American Heart Association has done a lot of work in, is educating patients to present early when they have signs of heart attack and signs of stroke. And we were seeing patients that were scared to come to the hospital, and they were presenting late into their heart attacks and late into their stroke and suffering irreversible damage from their heart attacks and their strokes. And that's something that we did at Mayo very early, was try and use social media to get the word out there to patients that it's safe to come to the hospital, and to remind them, you know, what are the signs of a heart attack and what are the signs of a stroke, and that you need to come as soon as possible and that we can safely take care of you. And so we consider those actually the indirect victims of COVID-19. Then later, we were hit like a ton of bricks by the second wave that happened in the fall. And we were seeing a significant number of patients that had what we call myocarditis, which is actually stress on the heart. We measure that by a lab called troponin. And we were seeing patients come into the hospital that had severe respiratory failure, but also very severe stress on the heart as well. And we're still learning what will the long-term sequelae and the long-term outcomes be in those patients that had the stress on that. And those are areas of research that are ongoing right now. And you know, we also had challenges even with visitor policies. Many of my colleagues in healthcare had to be the person there to be at the side of these patients, at their bedside, holding their hands, because we weren't allowed to have visitors. And we had patients that were unfortunately in our ICU dying alone. And so it's been stressful really on the healthcare system. There's been a lot of amazing positive things that have come out of this as well. We've learned how to be very resilient and how to create new care models very quickly. And that's something that, you know, we always joked about here, that if you wanted to change anything, it required, you know, 10 different committee meetings and a pilot. When COVID came, we had to act fast, and we had to create new care models and work as teams like we never had to do before. And I think we've learned a lot from that. And so that will be something that a positive that we take away from this experience. So what I think I'll do next, and as I want to say, if you submit, please submit any questions as we go. We are a smaller group. And so if questions come up as I'm going through these slides, please feel free to submit them, and Julie can chime in and share them with us. I'll show you some data that addresses some of the common questions that come up regarding COVID-19 and cardiovascular disease. So the first slide I have here is actually showing a couple, it's called a meta-analysis. So a summary of multiple studies that shows that patients that have COVID-19 were actually more likely across all of these studies to have cardiovascular disease. And also the prevalence of not just cardiovascular disease, but the risk factors for cardiovascular disease was also higher in all of these studies in patients that had COVID-19. So patients that had hypertension, diabetes, obesity, high cholesterol, all of these patients were also more likely to have COVID-19. And we knew that we were finding that patients that had underlying cardiovascular disease and the risk factors for underlying cardiovascular disease were also more likely to require hospitalization and sadly were actually more critically ill. What we didn't know is, were patients more likely to die if they had underlying cardiovascular disease. And what this graph is showing is that at the bottom, patients that didn't have cardiovascular disease or stress on the heart, as I mentioned earlier, what we call myocarditis or inflammation of the heart, if they didn't have either, they had the lowest mortality. Patients that had cardiovascular disease but no stress on the heart or myocarditis had a slightly but not significantly higher risk of mortality. Patients without underlying or known cardiovascular disease, but maybe risk factors that had inflammation of the heart had a mortality around 40%. But patients that were admitted with cardiovascular disease who ended up having inflammation of the heart from severe COVID-19 infection had mortality rates approaching 70%. And that was really concerning to us. And we were trying to work hard to identify patients early that would be at risk of becoming more critically ill and implement some of those evidence-based protocols, as I mentioned in the beginning, that we were working to develop. And this was all based on very limited evidence-based medicine, but we're trying to create protocols and based on the information that we had. Unfortunately, it's been very clear. This is one study, but there's been multiple studies that show that there are clearly racial and ethnic disparities in COVID-19 outcomes. This table here demonstrates that patients, Black patients, were significantly more likely to test positive with COVID-19. They were more likely to require hospitalization and more critically ill by requiring intensive care, and even slightly more likely to die if they had COVID-19. There's multiple theories across the literature to try and determine and look into why these disparities exist. Some of the theories and the thought process is that some of the patients, specifically from this study, that Black patients had higher incidence of cardiovascular risk factors, including diabetes and hypertension. But they're also socioeconomic contributors as well. And there's limited access to quality healthcare, as well as some of these communities had higher population density and made it challenging to quarantine. As I mentioned, we don't really know the long-term effects of COVID-19 specifically, but what we can do is actually extrapolate from prior experiences. So we do know the long-term outcomes of survivors of severe acute respiratory syndrome, which was the SARS endemic of 2003, as well as the Middle Eastern respiratory syndrome, which is another endemic that occurred in 2011. Both of these viruses are coronaviruses, just like COVID-19. They found that there was increased incidence of PTSD, depression, and anxiety. These patients, after even being treated and recovering, had reduced exercise capacity. And they also had more lung function abnormalities after being infected with these viruses. So what we know specifically from COVID-19 is more short-term data. The most common sequelae that we're seeing, and these are beyond the convalescent phase, so beyond the three-month period. Patients have more fatigue and muscle weakness. They're having difficulties with sleep, and they're suffering from more anxiety and depression. Patients who required ICU-level care during their hospital stay had more severe impaired lung function, even 3 months out from infection. And then specifically from a cardiovascular perspective, patients that suffered from COVID-19 had higher incidence of arrhythmias, heart failure, and ischemic heart disease. And this, there's multiple theories onto why these sequelae are occurring in patients with underlying cardiovascular disease. And it may be that what theory makes the most sense to me is that patients with cardiovascular disease have abnormal function of the blood vessels. There's more inflammation and more dysfunction of the blood vessels, and because of the cardiovascular disease, and that makes you more susceptible to these other outcomes of arrhythmia, heart failure, and even advanced ischemic disease. in this patient population. So we're starting to learn what should we do for these patients now that they've survived their hospital stay. Many institutions are developing post-COVID clinics. So these are multidisciplinary groups of healthcare providers, nurses, advanced practice providers, and physicians that are providing specific multidisciplinary care to COVID patients focused on the outcomes and the sequelae of their illness. Cardiopulmonary rehabilitation programs are actually working very hard to determine how can they help rehabilitate these patients in this current pandemic, because it's ongoing. And one of the greatest challenges is that how do we have people come in and exercise for recovery when we know that exercise actually generates aerosols and can put other people at risk? And so many institutions, including Mayo Clinic, are exercise physiologists. As I know Julie mentioned, her father is an exercise physiologist. Our exercise physiologists are working hard to determine how can we safely rehabilitate these patients while in a situation that's still higher risk. And research is ongoing. They're doing things like studying different air filters in the exercise labs and a lot of work in that area. There's neuropsychiatric care for the PTSD, including post-intensive care syndrome. So post-intensive care syndrome, or PICS, as we call it in critical care, is something that existed long before COVID, and clinics were just starting before the pandemic to become common practice to have follow-up care for patients that were in ICU. There's a lot of long-term neuropsychiatric effects from people that have to undergo or receive ICU care. And then something that I've been doing specifically is on multiple venues is educating physicians and other healthcare providers on how to follow up and what care and what things should they look at after hospitalization, which again is all developing, you know, on a daily basis. We're learning new information on how to best care for these patients and what kind of screening needs to be done post-hospitalization. So what can we do to lower our risk? So we all know that we heard the guidelines for physical distancing and masking, but what can we specifically do, physicians, your leaders in your practice, in your company? And we really have to act to be change agents. We have to lead by example, and we have to, you know the we have to be responsible for the quality of the data that we're sharing. And that's why I'm happy to answer any questions this evening in terms of any questions you have across the board in terms of what we're seeing, what recommendations we have for going forward for these patients. Another huge step that's going to make a big difference is vaccinations. Vaccines are safe and effective. They actually reduce your risk of getting the COVID in general, but also severe illness requiring hospitalization. And as I spoke about earlier, not only is the burden affecting patients with COVID-19 on hospitalization, but patients, there are indirect victims of this, people who have heart attacks and strokes that can't get into their hospital and get timely care because of the burden on the healthcare system. And then finally, we can control our cardiovascular risk factors. So staying active, controlling diabetes and hypertension are all going to lower your risk of getting infection, as well as, and if you do get infected, it'll actually decrease your risk of getting severe infection as well. So those are the slides that I had for you this evening. I'd like to open up at this time for any questions. I've provided my email and my Twitter handle here as well. And again, thank you very much for this opportunity to share this information with you this evening.
Thank you, Dr. Bennett. We did have a few questions submitted previously, so I can present a few of those to you. The first thing, and you touched on this a bit, but how has the impact of COVID on cardiovascular health disproportionately affected minority populations?
Yeah, so just in line with the data that I've shown, the effect has been it's disproportionate, and patients are requiring more hospitalization within the minority communities. There is more higher mortality in these populations. And we don't know yet, unfortunately, what the difference in long-term outcomes will be, but we already know that minority communities are getting sicker and having higher mortality from COVID-19.
Another question relates to if a vaccinated person contracts COVID-19, how, if at all, would the vaccine possibly affect any negative impact on cardio health?
So if someone is vaccinated and they become infected with COVID-19, they're less likely to get severe illness, which actually would also reduce the risk of severe cardiovascular outcomes. So less likely to develop heart failure, less likely to develop abnormal heart rhythms. In essence, if you're decreasing the risk of severe infection, you're also decreasing the risk of the cardiovascular consequences.
And again, you talked a little bit about this, but can you share with us your perspective on what you all have learned in terms of the long-term effects and how they differ if you've had a mild case versus a severe case?
Right. So patients the best way to differentiate this is patients that don't require hospitalization. So if you get a mild COVID-19 infection that you don't require hospitalization, your oxygen levels have not been affected, you haven't had any stress on the heart, you're very likely to have a full recovery and no long-term effects. Patients that are admitted to the hospital and have severe respiratory infection and severe inflammation, including the heart, or even something we didn't even talk about yet this evening was clots. We've seen a lot of incidents of patients who have COVID-19 that actually have a lot of clots. And so the patients that are hospitalized with these effects are the ones that are more likely to have abnormal lung function, reduced heart function, and need treatment for clots 3 months out and maybe even longer based on their risk factors.
And you talked about some of the effects afterwards. So after you get through that incubation period and you're kind of on the road to recovery, what is really the most negative long-term implications? And are there any steps that you could take to maybe mitigate those long-term effects?
Yeah, so I think the reduced exercise capacity, and again, we don't really know beyond a few months at this point, really what are going to be the best interventions, but the reduced exercise capacity has been something that we're finding patients are sent home on oxygen. They're still requiring oxygen after their hospitalization and their exercise capacity is low. And so something that is very helpful to these patients are these cardiopulmonary rehab programs and getting them some kind of monitored exercise program that helps get them back on the road to recovery. Because the best thing to do is get people active again. And also, as I mentioned before, help control for other risk factors that contribute to comorbidities.
And I know there's been some research that has shown that people that were more active and physically healthy had less severe complications.
Correct.
You're seeing about that research, would you agree with that?
Yes. So we agree that, we have had some cases, and actually not just here in Minnesota, but that's been written about in the literature of, these rare instances of these triathletes and these very fit people that have become severely ill, but that's really the minority that's really uncommon. And actually, without getting too scientific about it, these patients actually more likely have some abnormality in their immune system that's underlying, and research is actually undergoing in that. But overall, looking at everyone that's been infected with COVID, people that were more active and physically fit had less severe, less COVID overall, but then also less severe illness.
So there's a question that's come in on the chat about what happens. We know that the vaccine can't be 100% protection for you.
Correct.
Give us your view and opinion in terms of what protection measures we should be respecting for full protection, really keep the virus at bay, even though we've been vaccinated.
Yeah. So we know that actually even the CDC has said now that it is safe to, if everyone is vaccinated, that small groups can socialize if the whole group is vaccinated. But in general, if we're still going out to the grocery store and out to the stores, and we should still be wearing masks, that will help protect, you know, more vulnerable populations. That those are really continuing with the physical distancing is important. However, it is okay now in vaccinated groups to get together and socialize. And I'm not sure if I actually answered that question.
No, I think that was good. Yeah.
Okay.
So I similar question. You talked mm-hmm. about physical health, being cardiovascularly healthy is mm-hmm. being to mitigate it, even if you were to become sick. One of the questions that just come in is that cardiovascular health can be very tied to diet. And yes. You mentioned anything about diet and protecting against COVID, but have there been any studies related to diets of COVID patients?
No, so there has not been any, at least that I have reviewed up to date. I haven't seen any specific studies related to diet and COVID-19. However, I'm a critical care cardiologist. However, an interest or even hobby of mine is nutrition. And so we know that following a diet that's most similar to a Mediterranean diet, so a diet that's focused on large volumes of plants and grains and fruits and vegetables is healthy, and even including some healthy fats like extra virgin olive oil. And the reason that we think these diets are so beneficial to our cardiovascular health is actually because they improve the function of our blood vessels, something called endothelial function. And so these healthy diets actually make our blood vessels healthier. And so in my mind, it makes sense that if our diet is improving the function of our blood vessels, where the risk factors are actually making our blood vessels less functional, stiffer, and even making us more prone to disease, that theoretically a healthy diet would actually help lower your risk. Nutrition is very difficult to study because there's a lot of contributing factors that can't be controlled for. So I don't really anticipate that anytime soon we'll have a specific study looking at that unless it's something retrospective. But those are just, you know, my thoughts and opinion on it.
So one last question, what's your one piece of advice that you would share with all of us and hope that we remember it and share it with others?
That's a great question. I think specifically for this group, as I mentioned, you know, you are all leaders in your organization. And I really think that we don't realize it, but people are watching us. And as leaders, and so we need to be the change that we want to see, and you know, sharing that it's safe to get vaccinated, and continuing to demonstrate the physical distancing, and making sure that, you know, we are sharing quality knowledge, because misinformation has been one of the greatest challenges that we in healthcare have struggled with throughout this pandemic, and so making sure that you're following CDC guidelines or even reaching out to those of us in healthcare as a resource if there's questions, and sharing really quality information. And then of course, staying fit, staying active are always recommended, and you should continue doing those things as well.
Well, Dr. Bennett, thank you again for joining us today. Thank you for all of the care that you've given these critically ill patients over the last year as well. And for all that you're continuing to do in the cardiac research area, especially related to COVID-19. And I just wanted to encourage anyone else that's showing today, if you're interested in becoming involved with some of the local efforts that the American Heart Association is involved with in our San Diego community, by all means, please let us know. We want to share and we want to contribute to making our community healthier in the future. And on behalf of Deloitte and the American Heart Association, I thank you all for joining us tonight. Have a great rest of your evening.
Thank you. Thank you for this opportunity.